वेरी गुड इवनिंग डिस्टिंग्विश्ड गेस्ट सीनियर्स कलीग एंड डियर फ्रेंड्स ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ IMA गोरखपुर एंड एज द साइंटिफिक सेक्रेटरी ऑफ IMA आई एक्सटेंड अ वेरी हार्टी एंड वार्म वेलकम टू ऑल ऑफ यू टू दिस साइंटिफिक मीट ऑन क्रिटिकल टॉपिक्स लाइक एनीमिया ABG कार्डियोवैस्कुलर डिजीज कोविड एंड कैंसर आई एम वेरी होपफुल दैट दिस मीटिंग विल बी एक्साइटिंग एजुकेशनल एंड फुल ऑफ लर्निंग फॉर ईच ऑफ अस
गुड इवनिंग IMA गोरखपुर सो फॉर द फर्स्ट पार्ट ऑफ द डिस्कशन वी विटनेस्ड सम ऑफ द एक्सलेंट टॉक्स ऑन फ्यू वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट ब्रॉड स्पेशलिटीज विच आई गेट इन एवरी डे प्रैक्टिस एज अ सर्जन ऑफ हेड एंड नेक ऑनको कैंसर एनीमिया इज वन ऑफ द वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फैक्टर्स एनी कैंसर पेशेंट दैट गाइड अवर ट्रीटमेंट प्रोटोकॉल कार्डियक इशूज येस वी हैव पेशेंट्स एल्डरली पेशेंट्स ओनली येस्टरडे वी ऑपरेटेड अ पेशेंट विद इजेक्शन फ्रैक्शन ऑफ 25% ओनली ABG एनालिसिस फॉर लॉन्ग सर्जरीज पोस्ट ऑफ ICU एंड इट वॉज एन एक्सलेंट सेशन एंड वी ऑल नो कोविड हैज बीन a part and parcel of our life for the last 2 years. So from here, we carry on the discussion into a more narrower specialty and that is cancer. Through this, I am going to introduce you to a team, a new team, which is growing up to treat cancer in this part of the country. Before I start, I have a simple question to the revered audience. How many of you in your clinical practice encounter cancer patients? Can you please raise your hands? So quite a few. And so I think as a team, we start with oral cancer. I start with oral cancer and gradually the rest of our discussion will be on different cancers as subsites. Introducing myself, I am a head and neck cancer and reconstructive surgeon trained in Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai. And interestingly, most of our team hails from the same institute. So I have keen interest on head and neck ablative surgery, reconstructive surgery, skull-based surgery. Why I will cover my presentation on a few very salient features. Why oral cancer? What is the treatment protocol basic for a oral cancer? Why the patients present late to us? And definitely I will introduce my team to you. This is the Globocan data and it shows oral cancer is the second most common cancer in India overall. In men, it is the most common cancer. And in women, it is one of the common cancers. We all know, and I think we have some of the etiologies in this conference outside, that's alcohol. And for your kind information, alcohol is also a class 1 carcinogen. Just going through the potentially malignant disorders, because we have dental surgeons, general surgeons, ENT surgeons and onco surgeons all in this panel. So we get these things very commonly in the clinical practice. So this is a leukoplakia, that's erythroplakia, that's a submucous fibrosis again related to betel nut chewing, which is very common in the Indian subcontinent, and that's a lichen planus. So first three things are actually strongly precancerous lesions, which we today call as potentially malignant disorders. So oral potentially malignant disorders, I will go through a very basic approach how to treat this cancer, treat these disorders. This is a very common in this part of the country. So OPMD, first is when you see a patient of OPMD, first ask the patient quit your habits. That's the most important part. So quitting habits usually resolves the problem in around 40-50% of the subjects. If it does not resolve again, then if it resolves, the patient is kept on close follow-up if it does not resolve, persists or progresses, then that means with removal of the potential risk factors, the lesion is not disappearing. It has a high chance of being malignant. Either it is malignant as of now or it has a high chance of being malignant in future. So again, treat it like a malignancy, take a biopsy or do a excision with adequate margin. Please remember this point, do a excision with adequate margins and not just an excisional biopsy. The base and the mucosal margins should be adequate for these things. So there are a few issues I would like to say. Role of steroids, especially for oral submucous fibrosis, we have been all trained in our PG days and that this is steroids is a good thing, that it improves the mouth opening, it reduces the inflammation, everything is true. But you can see the in this name we have oral submucous fibrosis. The pathology lies in the submucosa. Again, with injecting steroids, we cause trauma in that submucosal layer, and that initially improves the mouth opening, but in long term when you stop the treatment it recurs. So steroids don't have a proven role in the treatment of oral submucous fibrosis. Again, no role of excisional biopsy. Either you biopsize it or you excise it with margins. There is some role of retinoic acid vitamin A. There has been studies which has shown some beneficial effects, but again retinoic acid has toxicity given systemically, may be given topically for some time, but it's not a standard of care. Coming to oral cancer, which is my topic, I will just cover the basic principles. So treatment of oral cancer is surgery. There is no second treatment option of cure for oral cancer. Workup is initially a biopsy and an imaging. I will go into details of this. Treatment is surgery. Early stage, you have surgery as the only treatment. Advanced stages, you have radiation and chemotherapy after surgery. Now, once you have a clinically and radiologically diagnosed unresectable oral cancer, don't resect an oral cancer when you cannot get a negative margin. It's as good as an upgraded biopsy. So, unresectable, there is no role of surgery. It's palliation, either radiation, chemotherapy, or radiation plus chemotherapy, or best supportive care. There is a part called borderline resectable cancers, which are plus minus resectable. We may or may not get a margin, or secondly, we may cause significant morbidity operating the subject. In those cases, we have a role for chemotherapy. I'll go into detail of this. Good response, you go and operate. Poor response, shift the patient to palliation. That's the basic principle. Again, surgery is the mainstay of treatment for oral cancer. Chemotherapy is rampantly practiced. I'm taking up these topics because these things I encounter in my daily practice. So chemotherapy is rampantly given in clinical practice by most practitioners in oral cancer, which does not have any role in oral cancer per se. Surgery is the main thing. Yes, there are conditions when the borderline resectable, that's a paper from Tata, our own institute, where we had a few conditions which have clearly mentioned if these conditions are present, there may be some role of chemotherapy as the initial management, and if we get a good response, we go on for surgery. No good response, send the patient to palliation. These are borderline oral cancers, not resectable. The problem with chemotherapy is that chemotherapy will always shrink the tumor, but when it shrinks the tumor, it doesn't shrink it concentrically, it shrinks it eccentrically, it reduces in patches. As a surgeon, when the patient comes to operating table, I don't have a clear image of the disease mapping in my mind when I operate this patient. So again, I may leave behind microscopic residual tumor, which I am not sure of. So chemotherapy is not again a protocol for operable cancers. If chemotherapy is planned, then for borderline resectable cancer, the disease has to be mapped very, very clearly before starting of chemotherapy, so that I am sure of my resection margin when the patient comes to table post chemotherapy. And another important point is accelerated repopulation of tumor cells, which happens after chemotherapy. Chemotherapy cannot be given lifelong. There is a limit to it. So when you stop chemotherapy, the tumor mutates and it starts behaving in a more aggressive fashion. So chemotherapy is not the first line of treatment. Neck dissection, yes, it's a necessity. We had a trial in our institute again in Tata, published in one of the most revered journals, NEJM, and we have shown very, very clearly that gives a survival benefit provided the neck has been addressed. I was a resident when this trial was being conducted in Tata Mumbai, and I honestly telling, I saw many people failing who were in the observation arm for neck. They presented to us small cancers, T1, T2 cancers, neck not addressed. Many have failed with large N3 unresectable neck nodes. So neck has to be addressed in any oral cancer patient, even if he is a clinically negative neck. Very important points, biopsy. I have some points which patients come and they tell these points, I have jotted these points. First of all, biopsy doesn't cause the cancer to progress. What it causes is some inflammation at the site of biopsy, which the patient mistakes for increase in the cancer. It's not a fact. Second thing, biopsy doesn't cause bleeding. The only structure that causes significant bleeding is injury of a main vessel of the neck, which is the carotid. No other vessel is there which causes life-threatening bleeding. So any bleeding stops by pressure and cauterization. Biopsy is not a painful if done in proper way. It's a OPD procedure and it doesn't require fasting blood sugar. So facts, I will come to this in the next slide. So these are proliferative lesions. This is a proliferative lesion, this is an ulcerative lesion. Again, a punch biopsy is adequate. For lesions like this, these are varicose lesions. Varicose lesions or proliferative lesions. So lot of keratin in these lesions. So taking a punch will bring up only keratin and not the basement membrane. For such lesions, you have to do a knife biopsy, go deep, take the basement membrane, and this basement membrane should be included to see whether there is invasion into the basement membrane or not. So many of these lesions come out to be negative on biopsy, but we have a paper from Tata, it's my own paper, and this has shown clearly that 50% of these lesions harbor malignancy when they were operated and sent for final histopathology. So don't ignore these lesions. These lesions can be malignant within. For small lesions like this, I have seen many patients coming. Yesterday only a patient came to me at a small lesion. Some surgeon just excised it and sent it for biopsy. It came out to be squamous cell carcinoma. Now the problem is that neck is not addressed. I don't know where the tumor was and I don't have a margin to resect. So there is no role of excisional biopsy for small lesion, how much tempting it may be. Do a biopsy and then label it as malignancy and then treat it like a cancer. Don't treat it, just excise and remove it and send it for pathology. Again, biopsy has to be taken from the most representative part of the tumor. For example, this erythroplakia, large area, this seems to be the most representative area. It's indurated, it's vascular. You touch the area, the patient complains of pain. So again, biopsy has to be done from the most representative area of the lesion. Imaging, Vikrant is there, I think. Vikrant does lot of imaging of our patients. So imaging, CCT, a thumb rule is that CCT or contrast enhanced CT scan is done for lateralized lesions or lesions where we suspect a bone erosion. Contrast MRI is done for midline lesions, tongue lesions, soft tissue delineation of the tumor. For any lesion, for any cancer imaging, contrast is must. Don't do a non-contrast imaging, it shows nothing. Imaging of the chest, PET CT scan are indicated only when the patient has a very advanced disease with regional nodes lower down the neck, level 4, level 5, high chance of metastatic neck disease, lung disease. We can do an imaging but it don't make chest CT or a PET CT routine clinical practice. It's not indicated in most cases as head and neck cancers is mostly loco-regional diseases. OPG are done very, very frequently in patients with oral cancers. A mandibular lesion OPG is done. Now, why not an OPG? These are the few reasons for this. OPG doesn't image the soft tissues. So we can't have an assessment of the soft tissues. Periodontitis is very common in India, and I am sure Abhishek will show it in the next slide what the national mouth is. So this is an important thing. Periodontitis gives very high false positive results. Symphysis menti region cannot be assessed, this region, because of the shadow of the vertebrae which comes behind it. And only visible bone loss is when it's a gross bone loss. Small bone erosions cannot be assessed on an OPG. So avoid an OPG, go for a contrast and CT scan with a puffed cheek technique. Ask the patient to puff the cheek so that the GB sulcus opens up and we can nicely see the sulcus. So this is a patient, I'm just going to tell a story of this lady. She presented to me a few days back, 33-year-old lady, two children, husband. She came to me with absolute trismus, no mouth opening. I asked her query, she said she had a small ulcer which has been there for last 3 years. Gradually, she kept on decreasing the mouth, and now she is having absolute trismus, not able to eat. She consulted a few doctors in between who have advised her some local triamcinolone or steroid injections and steroid creams to improve the mouth opening. When I put an endoscope inside, what I could see was something disastrous. This is a very, very advanced malignancy. This photo may disturb some people, but I'm sorry to say this is the harsh fact. This is the malignancy, extensive disease, skin indurated, intratemporal fossa involved, and that's the reason why she had so much of a trismus. And we operated the patient 5 days back only. Now, had this patient presented at 3 years back to us or some surgeon, and she was guided the right way, this is a cancer, this is going to be a problem for you, get it excised, she would have done much, much better. Now this is the outcome, and we had to put a large anterolateral thigh flap to reconstruct this defect, and see the mouth opening has improved, now operated 5th post-op day. So the point here is that our motto is catch them early, treat them early, so that we can give a better outcome both oncologically, functionally and cosmetically. This is another interesting paper from our own Tata, which has shown, you can see the result, they have prospectively seen the patient visited OPD and presented with stage 3, stage 4 cancers, and they have seen, read this results, majority delayed the decision to visit a physician early. This lady also did the same. A significant percentage also reported delayed diagnosis by the primary care physician before being referred to a tertiary care center for definitive diagnosis. Now this part we can change. Had this lady again come 3 years back, we would have given much better results to her. So that's a fact, and that thing has to be changed. So again, denial, ignorance, we need to work in the community level to change that. Improper guidance, this is what we can do, we can improve this thing, training ourselves, training the paramedical staff to improve this, and treatment cost, again, this is a very important factor which patients fear coming to a doctor. They fear getting they have to sell their whole house and lands and all for treatment, but this thing has to change. So for us, now I'm introducing you to a team. We have a team which is trained in Tata Memorial Hospital, and we are trying to develop this team all over the state and maybe later on all over the country, which gives a proper evidence-based treatment to all cancer patients. We do not believe in operating from head to toe or treating from head to toe. I cannot do the best surgery if I think I will operate every organ. That's our philosophy. So we are developing an organ based unit. Me as a head and neck surgeon, I have a team, Dr. Abhishek, Hemant, this is also Abhishek, Navneet, Ashutosh, Amit is there in the audience, Amit works with us, and myself. We have started a team, and gradually we are trying to increase the number of people, and we will raise the awareness among patients, among physicians, among paramedics, and try to treat the patients at a very, very, very affordable cost for cancer. Our strength as a head and neck unit, we are a ablative and reconstructive unit. We do our own reconstruction, we do our own ablation. So cost is maximally in our hands. Any patient who is not affordable, we treat at a very, very nominal rate. Our principles are that the patient who goes to Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai, gets the best treatment. We give the same treatment here at the same affordable cost, not at the cost which corporate hospitals offer. Again, our strengths, we do go for evidence-based treatment, multidisciplinary team, affordable costs, and our motto is service, research and education. So we keep on publishing, we keep on doing academics, and some of our few recent publications, one of these published in one of the revered journals of head and neck, the Laryngoscope, which is one of the best journals of the world. We have recently got a post, a fellowship from the AOMSI, who have taken our center or us as a team to train their fellows for the AOMSI part. And we in future, we also plan to get more fellows to train so that they can go out to the society and serve. That's all from my part. I will not take much time. We aim at a new dawn for cancer care in this part of the country. Thank you so much for your patience.
We are really suffering from the same situation, that there is a lot of patients where we are finding they are coming to T4A or T4B or metastatic patients that are not properly evaluated or diagnosed at the time when it was actually time when we can save the life of those patients. So, overall, Dr. Swamy, I want to know how often you find your patient in T1, T2. Because particularly from last 3 months or 4 months, I have found hardly 1 or 2% of patients, 99% patients we are getting T4.
That's the point I wanted to raise, because we get most of our patients as T3, T4, more than 80% are stage 4 cancers for us. And any, even in Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai, where I have worked for 7 years, I have seen the same situation. So that initially the patient with the early cancer, not very symptomatic, not very troubled, go out to the society, either they don't go to the physician or they go to the physician who, I am unfortunate to say, don't treat them mostly very, very well. So this thing has to change, yes, and I agree with Alok, most of our cancer patients are advanced, so we need to change their concept.
Thank you, Dr. Nice talk.